fashion. It's a very important bill given our goal of reaching the 33%, which is moving through the building today with respect to our renewable portfolio package. I also accept as author's amendments the amendments suggested in the analysis to ensure that the fee does not apply to applications where the review has been completed, and I ask for your support. Respectfully.
Thank you, Senator Rubio. We will go to testimony in favor.
Karen Lang on behalf of the Kern County Board of Supervisors. They're processing many applications. They've done what they can to expedite things at the local level. This bill will help a lot. We ask for your aye vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Additional testimony in favor?
Madam Chair and members, Don Gilbert representing TerraGen Power, working closely with the author. Love to see the bill move and support. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you. Melissa Cortez Roth on behalf of CalWIO, representing 25 renewable energy companies focused on the California market in support.
Thank you. Next, please.
Juanita Martinez on behalf
of turn the button up. There you go. No, it's on now.
Is it on? Okay. Juanita Martinez on behalf of Iberdrola in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Amber Reisenhuber for the Independent Energy Producers Association. We have also been working with the author and look forward to this bill moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Any additional testimony in favor? Is there opposition testimony? Any opposition testimony? Finance will take your comments. Good morning.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee, Miriam and Shanita with the Department of Finance. The bill would require the Department of Fish and Game to collect a $75,000 permit application fee from each developer of an eligible project. If these funds are inadequate to fund DFG's permit work, an additional fee of no more than $75,000 would be collected from the developer. Our understanding is that this amount would be sufficient to meet the Department of Fish and Game's costs for all the projects. With respect to the Energy Commission, it could increase the number of renewable energy facility siting applications to the Energy Commission. These and would be borne by the applicant fees. These fees accommodate approximately 50% of the CEC applications review costs. The balance of these would be borne by the Energy Resources Program account. And the CEC does estimate that the number of additional applications and costs, if any, would be absorbable.
Thank you very much. Support, opposition, finance, do pass as amended. Senator Ahlquist makes the motion. Any other comments, members? Then we can't call the roll, but we'll take a motion. Well, now we have one more. Nope. We still don't have a quorum.
Yes.
We do have a quorum now. Okay. So will you please call the roll? I'm gonna get a what do you call it? A complex.
Kehoe?
Here.
Kehoe here. Walters? Walters here. Ahlquist?
Here.
Ahlquist here. Emerson? Liu? Pavley? Price?
Here.
Price here. Runner?
Here.
Runner here. Steinberg?
We have five. We have a quorum. Thank you, members. And we have a motion by Senator Ahlquist on SB 16 by Senator Rubio. And will you please call the roll?
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters?
No.
Walters, no. Ahlquist?
Aye.
Ahlquist, aye. Emerson? Liu? Pavley? Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner?
No.
Runner, no. Steinberg?
The count is 3-2. We'll keep the roll open for on call.
Thank you.
And for the absent member, Senator Rubio. Next, we have SB 497.
Madam
and
Chair.
This is a candidate for suspense, Senator.
Therefore, Madam Chair, I'd waive presentation on this bill.
Thank you very much. We will deal with that when we take up the suspense files. I will call for support and opposition. Any support on SB 497? Is there opposition? Okay, come on, sir. Now is your turn to speak. Come on up here and take a seat. And tell us your name.
My name is Marvin Dean. I'm actually here to speak on behalf of two bills.
One second. We're on SB 497
yes,
by Senator Rubio.
Yes, that's the one. I'm new to this process, so excuse me.
Okay,
my name
right.
is Marvin Dean. I'm representing the Kern County Minority Contractors Association and also the San Joaquin Valley Black Contractors Association. And we are very in support of this bill that our senator from the Valley is pushing.
You're in support.
In support. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, sir. And it's going to be held in suspense for a few weeks. We'll deal with it a little bit later in the session. Is there any opposition? Finance, do you have a comment on this one?
The Department of General Services estimates that the implementation of this bill could increase state contracting costs by $56 million to $63 million annually, which would be paid by various funding sources, including the general fund. DGS estimates that it would require additional staffing in order to establish a process to verify the businesses meet the criteria in the bid for the bid preferences, and would require $1.3 million to support 10 additional AGPAs.
All righty, thank you. We will deal with those issues while it's in suspense. Thank you, Senator Rubio. And we will go now to Senator Padilla. There's two items here. SB 26, would you like to start with that one, Senator?
Yes, good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. SB 493 is the other bill recommended for suspense. I'll waive presentation on that. And I know SB 26 is also a candidate for suspense, but wanted to take a few minutes, if you'd indulge me, as to why I've introduced a bill and have focused on this issue for many, many years. And by way of history and chronology here, the story begins in 2006 when in Sao Paulo, Brazil, a prison gang used cell phones to organize simultaneous riots in 73 prisons. And more ominously, inmates used these same cell phones to help direct street gangs to attack Sao Paulo police officers in the streets, effectively shutting down the financial capital for several days. And as I said, it was learned that these prisons and gang leaders were having regular conference calls on their cell phones to coordinate these criminal activities. And so in 2007, as I was transitioning into the Senate, I began asking CDCR officials, could this happen here? It seems sort of a far stretch or a far leap in the imagination to think, oh, well, that may be Sao Paulo, Brazil, but this is California. And in fact, CDCR confirmed that, like in Brazil, California inmates are using cell phones to communicate with inmates within the same prison, with other prison, and with people in communities to coordinate criminal activities. The year of the Sao Paulo riots, in 2006, California prisons confiscated 261 cell phones from the hands of inmates. In last year, that number grew to more than 11,000. So clearly the problem is growing, and it's growing exponentially. And it's not just growing here in California, it's growing throughout the country. Last year, President Obama responded to the threat of inmates using cell phones to coordinate violent and criminal activity in our federal prisons by signing legislation to ban them, and that measure called for a 1 year of prison time for anyone caught smuggling a cell phone to a federal prisoner. In that time since Sao Paulo, we've seen 43 states in the nation take action on this issue, and some of them have passed some very tough laws. For example, in the state of Illinois, if you bring in or possess a cell phone, it's a Class 1 felony and you face 4 to 15 years in prison. In Colorado, smugglers face 19 months in prison and a $100,000 fine. In Oregon, not exactly the reddest of states, smugglers face 5 years in prison and a $125,000 fine. So clearly there's a consistency in the response of all these other states. They're cracking down, and they're cracking down hard. But nowhere in the nation is a problem bigger than it is here in California. Last year, after several attempts, bipartisan attempts, mind you, we finally got a bill to the governor's desk, and Governor Schwarzenegger vetoed it. He said the bill wasn't strong enough. So just to highlight some context here, for many years, the legislature has tried to get a bill to the governor's desk, and because of the ROCA policy and public safety, fiscal concerns given our budget, there's been a big hesitancy to create a new felony in California. Yet, we had a governor who wasn't willing to sign a bill if it wasn't the creation of a new felony. Well, today things are different. If nothing else, we have a new governor, and I believe a governor who gets it. In his time as Attorney General, I think he learned and appreciated the significance and the urgency of the issue. There's also a growing coalition of support for doing something about the issue and specifically behind the bill that's before you. The list of support includes the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, the sheriffs and police officers and police chiefs associations, the District Attorneys Association, and many victims' rights groups, and many others. The bill before you, I think, is pretty straightforward, and I think it is tough enough to make inmates think twice and smugglers think twice about breaking the law. The bill would make smuggling a cell phone by anyone a misdemeanor punishable by 6 months in jail and a $5,000 fine per device. It would also add cell phone possession to the list of offenses that warrants an inmate's loss of good time credits. I understand the bill's a candidate for suspense and the costs associated with the inmate's loss of time credit that are included in the committee analysis. But let me take this opportunity to present a different argument. I believe this bill could help the state save money. I've come to recognize that cell phones in the hands of dangerous inmates are crime multipliers. We don't suspect, we know that they are being used by inmates to commit and coordinate crimes both inside and outside of prisons. Allowing inmates to organize criminal activity results in more crimes. It results in more victims, in more arrests, in more trials, in more convictions, and more inmates and lengthier sentences for our prison system. This past September, when our current governor was still attorney general, he announced the arrest of 4 high-profile street gang leaders and 30 gang members. Several of those arrested were allegedly given orders to commit murder and other violent crimes by prison gang leaders who sent them messages with their cell phones. Attorney General Brown summed it up neatly, and I'd like to quote from his statement. Incarcerated inmates are supposed to be serving their time out of circulation, but because of the introductions of cell phones, these individuals in prison are maintaining their roles and their hierarchical position in a gang.
Okay, very good,
the
Senator.
The bill, I believe, would reduce costs by preventing the crimes that the cell phones are currently facilitating.
All right.
And I would appreciate the consideration of the committee's
support
when
testimony?
The suspense file
Thank
is
you,
considered.
Senator. Support, please, now.
Good morning. I'm Terry McDonald, the Chief Deputy Secretary for Adult Operations for the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. Thank you for your time this morning, and thank you for Senator Padilla's ongoing commitment to help us with what I believe to be the largest public safety problem facing our prison systems today. Senator Padilla states clearly and articulately that the lines of criminality are blurring between our prisons and the streets. Offenders are using cell phones to bypass our systems to review the use of the phone system, and they're terrorizing victims in the community. They're ordering hits on people in the community, including our own staff, and they're doing child pornography and victim terrorization. We need assistance with dealing with this very serious issue. It's a national issue, just not a California issue, and so we urge your support this morning to assist us with this very serious problem.
Thank you. Next, please.
Good morning. I'm Nancy O'Malley. I'm the District Attorney of Alameda County, and I'm here also on behalf of the California District Attorneys Association. I actually have prosecuted a case where a very, very serious, brutal gang rape of a 15-year-old girl, who all 4 of the defendants were convicted and sent to prison. Within about 10 years, almost on the anniversary date of this brutal rape, that young woman got a phone call from one of the defendants. And when we tried to figure out how it was possible that he could be calling her, we realized that he had a cell phone in prison. And what he was telling her was recounting the facts of what they had done to her, told her what she was wearing, told her that he and his friends were going to be out to see her soon. She was so afraid that she literally passed out from fear. And when we did the investigation, what we discovered was that there were over 1,000 cell phones that were being moved around in a 24-hour period, and that the defendant who I had convicted of this serious gang rape had paid $1,000 for 24-hour use of that cell phone. That led us to do more investigations, and in the last year and a half in Alameda County, we prosecuted successfully and convicted the head of a gang who was really terrorizing Oakland, West Oakland, who was conducting his business from a cell phone from the prisons. We have had information from the inmates for our investigations that some of the prisoners in the corrections have the judges' addresses that they're getting from Google. They're going to one individual we heard about recently who has a Facebook page, and he was convicted of murdering a man And the widow of that murder victim saw this on TV, saw the Facebook page of the man who murdered her husband, that he was uploading daily or keeping up daily through the use of cell phones. In our investigation, we see just how prevalent these cell phones use are. And I can tell you that the victims do not feel safe, and they're not safe when in the hands of the inmates and the people that are in prison for committing the crimes against them are now using them to terrorize them further. I agree with Senator Padilla and with the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation that we will prevent crime. What these cell phones are doing is bypassing security, and if we don't know what's going on, then we're going to have more crime on the streets. And I just urge you to consider moving this.
To CDCR, how do the phones get in the prison?
They come in as many ways as you can fathom.
Such as?
Employees will bring them in. Visitors bring them in, hidden in their shoes.
What do you do with employees that bring them in?
We serve to dismiss them is what we'd go to do with them.
But it's currently not a crime.
Good. Yeah. And how many were dismissed last year?
I understand eight. We had about 200 investigations. Eight were dismissed. But you have to remember that there's a process.
You're talking about thousands of phones in the prisons right now today.
Yeah, but they're not all coming in by employees. They're coming in boxes. They're coming in packages. And the reality of this bill helps us deal with that problem. It makes offenders higher risk for them to do it, and for employees higher risk for them to do it. There's no consequences.
Boxes would be inspected by employees, wouldn't they? And
I would love to take anybody who would like to go with me to Avenal State Prison. We have an outdoor work environment run by the Prison Industry Authority, and we have one employee that works out there, and it's in the middle of nowhere. And so inmate gang groups drive up in Humvees and drop off cell phones over this small fence. And then when a staff member's over here looking, the inmates go grab this box of cell phones, they hide it in a PIA box, it gets loaded into a truck and brought in through the Sally Port. We would need hundreds of staff to deal with that.
Thanks.
First of all, I'm very supportive of this bill, but I do have a question because I understand the costs associated with it. Have you talked to the cellular phone companies to see if there's a way to completely block access to cell phone coverage in the prisons?
Yes. I mean, let me also suggest this. This bill isn't the single tool that's going to eliminate the problem by itself. It's part of a comprehensive strategy and solution, in my opinion, that would involve not just consequences for inmates who unlawfully possess cell phones and consequences for people who smuggle the cell phones in. That's what my bill addresses. There are technology solutions such as managed access, and that's what you're talking about. The department, and I'll let them speak for themselves, has been piloting application of the technology. They can't share too much information given public safety concerns and other sensitive considerations. It is being done with some success in other states, but they're not mutually exclusive. Issues like managed access, issues like better screening of everybody, not just visitors, everybody coming in and out of prisons. But the fact of the matter is that today there are no consequences either for the inmates who are caught with cell phones, and there are no consequences for either a visitor or an employee who is caught smuggling cell phones in, and that is unacceptable.
More testimony in favor? Any other comments from members? More testimony in favor, and we'll need those chairs, please. Thank you.
Good morning. The California State Sheriff's Association and the California Probation, Parole, and Corrections Association is in full support. Thank you.
And your name, please, sir?
Curtis Hill, H-I-L-L.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dawn Kapke with McHugh & Associates on behalf of Crime Victims United in support for the reasons already stated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Craig Brown for the California Correctional Peace Officers Association in support.
Thank you. Any other testimony in favor? Is there opposition? Seeing none, Finance, you have some comments?
The cost for longer sentences that could result from this bill would be approximately $25,000 general fund to $50,000 general fund per inmate per year, and approximately $200,000 per ward per year. I do not have an estimate at this time for any cost avoidance savings that CDCR may receive as a benefit of this bill.
Thank you. All righty. This is a candidate for suspense, members. And Senator Padilla, you've waived presentation on the next one. Let me just call for testimony in favor of SB 493. surplus property. In favor? Seeing none, any opposition testimony? And Finance, do you have a comment on SB 493?
The Department of General Services indicates that they would incur costs of approximately $100,000 in 2010-11 to contract with an entity to perform the research necessary to meet the reporting requirements in the bill. Additionally, to the extent that surplus PCs are purchased by ARRA grantees, the Department of General Services could experience a reduced level of auction revenue from the sale of PCs to the public. And any auction revenue beyond the cost incurred by DGS to sell the property is returned to the departments, presumably helping them to offset operating costs.
Thank you. All righty, and that item goes to suspense as well. Thank you, Senator Padilla.
Thank you, Madam Chair. If I just may, in closing on SB 26.
Very briefly.
Briefly, because you heard from the Department of Finance what the fiscal impact could be per ward, per prisoner with the bill. I would ask the Department of Finance, and I would ask this committee to consider what the cost savings would be when addressing the issue of cell phones in prisons, the crimes that we can prevent, the suffering that we can prevent, and the savings that would accompany less people going to prison because of those crimes being prevented. Thank you.
Thank you. And Senator Lowenthal, you have two items?
I believe they're both candidates for suspense. I'd like to give brief presentations on both, if I can.
Please go right ahead. SB 128 on high-performance schools.
SB 2, Madam Chair, members, SB 128 does two things. It allows career technical education construction projects to be eligible for funding under the High Performance School Program, and it allows modernization projects to include new green building systems, also known as high performance systems. Basically, the School Facility Modernization Program provides funding to renovate school facilities that are at least 25 years of age, but current law does not allow for a new high-performance system to be funded under the modernization. It's a like-for-like replacement. Any new systems that have come out, they cannot be used. We found that high-performance systems facilities can affect academic performance. Daylighting, clean, well-circulated air, good acoustics can all contribute, and that school districts can save a great deal of money in terms of building in energy efficiency and energy generation systems. SB 128, we believe, does not add any cost to the state. The bill simply allows local flexibility for the use of existing state funding programs. So all we're doing is expanding the eligibility to now have in their modernization, new green performance projects, and also to allow under the high performance schools, you can now target also career technical education. We'll ask for an aye vote.
Thank you, Senator Lowenthal, and we'll go to your witnesses in support.
Tom Duffy, Madam Chair, members for the Coalition for Adequate School Housing, in support of this bill. Just to recognize that under the modernization program, it would really be an option for the district to use the grants for this. There's no additional funding that would be provided, so that this would be a district using those grant funds in a way to achieve these high performance goals. We believe that the inclusion with the career technical education program is something that may in fact advance the goals of career technical education, because high performance we're seeing more and more as a curricular offering within school districts. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, please.
Madam Chair and members, I'm Sharon Scott Dow, representing the Advancement Project, and we're in support of the bill.
Thank you very much. Any additional testimony in favor? Is there opposition? Finance, do you have a comment?
Currently, approximately $76 million in HPI funds remain available to encourage the use of high-performance attributes in school construction. This measure could redirect existing modernization funds from modernizing existing schools to fund only high-performance attributes, and we just note that as a concern.
All righty. That is a candidate for suspense, so we will move on to SB 140, Senator, on instructional materials.
Thank you. I'm going to present briefly on this one. Also, the State Board of Education adopted the Common Core Standards in English Language Arts and Mathematics in August of 2010. Our process of reviewing and updating curricula frameworks and adopting instructional materials, as we did in the 2009 budget, has been suspended, so we have no process in place for new instructions. However, at the same time this is going on, there are two different consortia of states are working to develop assessments for the Common Core, which potentially will be available in 2014 and 15. So our students are going to be assessed on the Common Core by 2014 and 15, but there's no instructional materials for them because we've suspended the development and the adoption of instructional materials. So we need to ensure that our students have the opportunity to learn these new standards and be prepared for an assessment on these new standards, and we need to act quickly. And so what we do is to allow instructional materials to be adopted that provide a bridge between the existing standards aligned instructional materials that are currently used in schools and the Common Core standards, and SB 140 authorizes school districts to adopt instructional materials that are aligned with the Common Core standards. And this authority is also extended to include instructional materials for grade 1 to 8. Those districts that do not wish to do this or do not have the capacity to conduct a local adoption, the bill requires the Department of Education to develop a list of instructional materials that are aligned with the Common Core standards. And the Board of Education must either adopt or reject this list of materials. It gives maximum flexibility and options to school districts. That's what we want them to have now as we're going through this transition. And we do not want to penalize our California students to be assessed when they are not, when we do not have instructional materials that go along with the assessments. I ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Senator. And your witnesses?
Sherry Griffith with the Association of California School Administrators. We're the sponsor of the measure. For the committee's knowledge of how this has worked in Common Core, the standards are actually more similar than different than our current math and English language arts standards. However, without SB 140, we won't be able to use our current books without that bridge. And so as a cost-effective measure, we think that SB 140 will allow us to use the current books that we've spent millions on with a supplement to create that bridge in the short term. In the long term, we don't anticipate new textbooks until after 2014, so we think it's critical. What's key about this, though, is that the list is a voluntary list. Districts can utilize their own funding locally, and they make the choice if they need the materials. So with that, we would ask for your support.
Thank you. Next, please.
Andrew Keller on behalf of San Francisco Unified School District. For the reasons stated before us, we are in support.
All righty.
Dale Shimasaki with the Association of American Publishers. We have a supportive amended position on the bill. The amendments that we're requesting are clarifying. We're working with the author's office just to get that cleaned up, and hopefully we'll get it resolved before it gets out of this committee.
All righty.
Thank you.
Any other testimony in favor? Is there opposition testimony to SB 140? Seeing none, Finance, do you have a comment?
Madam Chair, I don't have a file on this measure.
All righty. Then this one goes to suspense as well, Senator. Thank you.
Thank you.
Members, we have Senator Negrete McLeod on one item, that is SB 578. And then members, I'm going to go to committee members who have bills so we can keep moving if no other members come forward, okay? So, Senator Pavel, you've waived presentation, right? And Senator Price, you have a couple. I have a couple. I guess that's about it. Okay. Welcome, Madam Negrete McLeod. How are you?
I am fine. Thank you, Madam Chair.
And you're just doing one. Is that
I'm
correct?
Doing one. I wait presentation on the other.
So and SB 578 on
that is
foster
correct.
Care.
Yes. SB 578 would require each public school district and county office of education to issue and accept full or partial credits for coursework satisfactorily completed by a dependent or ward while attending a public school, juvenile court school, or non-public non-sectarian school or an agency to be applied to core curriculum and graduation requirements. Sometimes transferred credits are applied toward elective requirements rather than to the core curriculum. For example, Algebra 1 credits are applied as credits toward the elective requirement instead of being applied to the regular core math requirement. The practice results in foster youth lagging behind their peers, often losing months of academic progress with each change in school placement through no fault of their own. Additionally, this can lead to the student choosing to drop out of high school rather than complete additional coursework already completed. To ensure that these youth continue to advance academically, that it is vital that school districts provide opportunities for them to earn the credits that they are missing. I am prepared to accept the amendments suggested by the committees as author amendments.
Thank you.
Okay, and I have with me here my witnesses.
Let's go to your support.
Tim Lynch on behalf of the San Bernardino County Board of Supervisors, and we're the sponsors of the bill. With Foster graduation rates hovering around 50%, we thought this was a great bill to encourage graduation and get our foster kids off to a good start once they do finish high school.
Sherry Griffith with the Association of California School Administrators. We're in support.
Madam Chair and members, I'm Sharon Scott Dow representing Advancement Project in support.
All righty. Any additional testimony in favor? Is there opposition testimony? Any opposition testimony? Finance, we'll have your comments.
From a statewide perspective, by prohibiting schools from requiring foster care students to retake all or portions of coursework for which full or partial credit has been granted, this bill may in fact eliminate duplicative coursework and thereby eliminate unnecessary daily average attendance costs for both local school districts and the state. As a result, while the bill may create some amount of state reimbursable mandate costs, we believe that the costs would be more than offset by savings from reducing duplicative coursework.
Yes.
Thank you. Members, Senator Negrete McLeod has taken amendments to this, so I'll take a motion.
I move as amended.
Do pass as amended. Any comments, members, additions? All righty, then we will call the roll.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters?
Aye.
Walters, aye. Alquist?
Aye.
Alquist, aye. Emerson?
Okay,
Emerson, aye. Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye. Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner?
Aye.
Runner, aye. Steinberg? Steinberg, aye.
And only Ted Lewis missing. All righty, that's 8-0. The bill is out.
Thank you.
We'll take your wave in when I get to a break in the action, okay?
Thank you.
And so we'll go to Senator Berryhill. Is next, please.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair, members.
Good morning, Senator. Thank you. Go right ahead.
Thank you.
This is SB 361 on school funding.
Yes, it is. And Madam Chair, thank you for this opportunity to present 361, legislation sponsored by the Fresno and Clovis Unified School Districts, both of which are in the 14th Senate District. The Center for Advanced Research and Technology is an excellent program, and this year, a study from the James Irvine Foundation praise the school for its increased graduation and college attendance rates for all demographic groups. Members, I believe that this bill truly is important for students in the Central Valley, as it maintains current funding levels in an excellent opportunity program. This does not create additional appropriation. And for these reasons, I do ask for your aye vote. With me today is Nancy Lacaze from the School of Services of California, who will testify in support of this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Go right ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members of the committee. My name is Nancy Lacaze, and I am representing Clovis Unified School District as well as CART itself, which is the JPA. And we ask for just a continuation of this funding formula, which is helping these districts and this effort to be very successful. Thank you.
Good morning, Michelle McKay Underwood on behalf of Fresno Unified School District in very strong support of SB 361.
Any other testimony in favor? Testimony in favor? Any opposition testimony? Finance will take your comments, please.
The bill would not impose an additional 98 general fund cost to the state. Instead, the language that currently contained in the bill would allow CART program to continue to receive the same level of general purpose funding from the ROCP funding that the CART is currently receiving.
Thank you. Senator, good try on no cost, but the program does cost annually, and that's what the both the finance analysis and the staff analysis refers to. So we'll work on that while it's in suspense.
Okay, great. Thank you, Matt.
Thank you very much for presenting.
Okay, thank you.
And that item goes to suspense, members. Senator Wolk, welcome. And you have two items.
I do. Item 27.
SB 508. Mm-hmm. Go right ahead, whenever you're ready.
Madam Chair, members of the committee,
We can all agree today that today's finance, public finance system requires major reform. I have pursued changing our budget system to apply performance-based budgeting to programs. That's SB 14. This bill will attempt to apply the same methodology to future tax expenditures. It would require all future tax expenditures to state the goals of the tax preference, identify specific indicators and data measurements to see whether or not it works. The bill also requires any bill to come forward that asks for a tax expenditure to create put in place a seven-year sunset. Too often we create these preferences and they stay in place forever because they can only be changed by a two-thirds vote. While we cannot change existing tax preferences, we can at least start keeping better track of future ones, and I ask for an aye vote.
Thank you, Senator Wolk. Testimony in favor. Is there testimony in favor? Come on up now. And then we'll go to opposition. Welcome.
Stephanie Brew, representing SEIU Local 1000 in support.
All righty. And any other in favor testimony? Then we'll go to opposition. Please come on up, and then we'll go to finance. Welcome. State your name.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members. Mira Gerton here on behalf of the California Chamber of Commerce in opposition to this measure. We believe that the automatic sunset provision will create hidden costs for California by discouraging employers from investing here, undermining certainty in our tax credit programs and our investment in maintaining a competitive tax climate in the future. Thank you.
Madam Chair, members, Chris McKaylee on behalf of the California Grocers Association, my colleagues at the California Manufacturers and Technology Association and California Taxpayers Association also join in this and ask me to express their continuing opposition. We have the same position as we did last year, which is seeking an amendment. It's on the second part. We agree with the performance metrics, have no issue with that. Our concern is not even having a sunset date, but that an arbitrary seven-year one be imposed across the board. Just like performance metrics, there shouldn't be a one-size-fits-all for each type of tax credit, so too the sunset date ought to be modified to fit what is appropriate for that particular tax incentive. Thank you.
Any other testimony in opposition? Any other testimony in opposition? Finance, do you have any comments?
I don't have a file on this matter.
All righty. Members, then we have a do pass. Senator Ahlquist, thank you for the motion. Do pass. Comments, members? I'll call the roll then.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters?
No.
Walters, no. Ahlquist?
Aye.
Ahlquist, aye. Emerson?
No.
Emerson, no. Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye. Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner? Steinberg.
I'm sorry.
Senator Runner.
Runner, no.
All right. And we're going to hold the roll open for the absent members. The count is 4-3. Needs one more. Senator Wolk, you have SB 580. Please
580.
Go right ahead. And this is a candidate for suspense.
All right. Madam Chair and members, SB 580, first of all, I'd like to acknowledge my joint author, Senator Kehoe, and thank her for her advocacy for parks. SB 580 is a reintroduction of 679 and was passed by this committee. It preserves the integrity of California's parks system and protects the taxpayers' investment in our parks. We're very privileged in California to have an extraordinary park system. 278 parks, more than a million acres of diverse natural, cultural, and historical treasures. 580 will institute clear statutory protection, puts in place a process to safeguard state parks, which, of course, the federal government already has and some local governments have. And this establishes that process to balance competing interests and demands on our state parks lands when proposals come forward to change the configuration of a state park. I respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Senator Wolk. The analysis calls out on the second page that if the state decided to sell a dedicated parkland or portions thereof to generate general fund revenues or reduce operational costs, I think, to tell you the truth, I think it's a little bit of a stretch, but this could be I could accept a do-pass motion as well, Senator Ahlquist. But first we'll have our testimony, both pro and con, and hear from finance. So support testimony, please.
Good morning, Madam Chair and members. Tracy Verado-Torres with the California State Parks Foundation. We share the chairwoman's expression that we think it would be a stretch to actually sell state park lands for the express purpose of trying to generate funding for the state. And we agree with the analysis that there are frankly so many constraints on the existing state park lands right now that it would not make it financially feasible, let alone on behalf of the State Parks Foundation, whether that would be from a policy level advisable at all. One thing also in terms of looking at the opportunities with our state parks, it is important, and obviously beyond the scope of this committee specifically, but it's important to always remember that state parks in fact generate funding for the state right now in terms of tourism, in terms of sales tax, payroll tax, transient occupancy taxes for people who are visiting state parks and spending money in the attending and neighborhoods related to state parks. So we respectfully ask for your aye vote on SB 580.
Thank you. Additional testimony, please.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, I'm Christopher Trunell here on behalf of the Nature Conservancy and for the reasons previously stated by my colleague, and very strong support of this bill. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Additional testimony in favor? Is there any opposition testimony? Opposition, please come on up. Go right ahead.
Thank you. Mira Gerton here on behalf of the California Chamber of Commerce. I'll be very brief. Our concerns are all policy related, so it's the substance of our opposition.
All righty. Next, please.
Moira Topp on behalf of the Orange County Transportation Authority. I apologize for late opposition on this bill. The board just met this morning, but we are opposed to the bill. We think it's duplicative of existing current federal and state law and would increase litigation in a lot of these circumstances and therefore are opposed to the bill.
All righty. Next, please.
Mark Smith on behalf of the American Council of Engineering Companies of California. On the fiscal side of the bill, we think this bill introduces a concept that at this point in time is exactly the wrong concept that we need in order to appropriately manage our state parks. It locks the state park system into its current perspective without the ability to be flexible and deal with the severe fiscal constraints that the state is facing in regards to the state park system management. Excuse me, I just ran down the stairs. The voters in November decided that they no longer wanted to provide additional funding to state parks. That may change in the future, but it doesn't change the current snapshot. This legislature also continually underfunds the responsibilities of the state park system. So to impose this requirement on the state parks now, at a time when all of you may need the flexibility in order to appropriately manage the state park system from a fiscal perspective, is irresponsible. And for those reasons, we oppose this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other testimony in opposition to the bill? Opposition. Finance, do you have a comment?
This bill would increase the costs of the disposal of state park system lands by making such disposal subject to a lengthy and cumbersome process by requiring the acquisition or transfer of equivalent lands under specified circumstances. Because this bill would only permit monetary compensation to parks for the disposition of transfer of state park system lands in limited circumstances, the bill would essentially prohibit the administration from reducing the size of the California state park system, which may otherwise be desired for a number of reasons, including the reduction of general fund support costs for the department.
Thank you. And Senator Walters.
Madam Chair, I would propose that we do move this bill to suspense in light of what finance has just testified on the cost and the cost to maintain another park. I mean, we're facing a fiscal crisis in this state, and I think we need to further look at this bill.
Thank you for your comments, Senator. I want to return to my original comments that, and also to the testimony on from the Parks Foundation. And I should also ask the author to respond too, but the constraints on selling park lands, I think, would make the possibility of substantial help for the general fund due to a sale so remote that I don't really think that there's a legitimate suspense issue here. Author, Senator Wolk, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
I agree with the chair of the Appropriations Committee that the policy of always wise to do that. I do believe that that's a fundamental policy question that would not happen. The bill does not lock anything into place other than a policy, a process through which much litigation and much unhappiness could be avoided by setting up, again, a process by which these issues of power lines or roads or other changes to the park system can be dealt with in a transparent and open process. I think that would be a good idea, and I frankly think in the long run that saves the taxpayer a great deal of funding through because of the litigation issues, and I think the Orange County situation is an excellent example of that.
Any other comments, members? We have a motion from Senator Ahlquist, do pass, and if there's no further comments, then I'll call the roll.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters?
No.
Walters, no. Ahlquist?
Aye.
Ahlquist, aye. Emerson?
No.
Emerson, no. Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye. Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner?
No.
Runner, no. Steinberg?
That is 4-3. You need one more, Senator Wolk. I'll leave the roll open for the absent members.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members.
And do we, Senator Price, would you like to take up your two items? They're both candidates for suspense. You're going to waive 141. Thank you. And if no members show up while Senator Price is at the podium, then I'll take up my two. All right? Senator Price, go right ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members. SB 67 authorizes the Department of General Services to direct state departments and agencies to achieve the goal of 25% small business participation in procurement and contracts, and empowers DGS to assist agencies to meet the goal. The bill codifies the former governor's executive order SO206 and ensures that some of the ground that small businesses has gained in state procurement and contracting within the last few years will continue in the future, regardless of party. Since the issue is already in effect, the costs to administer the provisions of the bill are minor and absorbable, as indicated on page 2 of the Appropriations Committee's analysis. Over the past two fiscal years, state agencies have met and or exceeded 25%. Have met or exceeded the 25% goal. Codifying the executive order will contribute to the continued success of California's small businesses in state procurement and contracting and support their roles as key drivers of job growth and economic development in the state's recovery efforts. Small businesses are expected to play a critical role in our state's recovery. However, little support has been provided to assist them, and SB 67 provides the support we think to achieve this goal. With me today are, I do recognize it is a candidate for suspense. We don't agree with that. And we have here today representatives from a broad cross-section of organizations up and down the state that support and advocate for small businesses.
Thank you, Senator. And we'll go to your testimony. I know you've reviewed the analysis, and the analysis does point out that there could potentially be multi-million dollar costs, and that's why it has the suspense file on the analysis. But we're happy to listen to testimony, and we'll work with you while it's on suspense. And let's go to your witness. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you, Chair and committee members. I'm Betty Jo Ticoli. I'm president of the California Small Business Association, and we represent over 200,000 businesses through small businesses throughout the state. I'm kind of perplexed that this bill is considered a cost. I consider it a revenue creator, and I'd like to share with you the chair of the Senate Committee on Small Business and Entrepreneurship from Congress, because I'm only going to share half of her words because of time, but it talks about we can help increase sales for small businesses and boost job creation on Main Street because of the unique way contracting opportunities can stimulate job growth for small businesses. When large businesses get government contracts, they can potentially absorb that new work into their workforce. When small businesses get government work, they must staff up to meet the increased demand. Perhaps the biggest benefit to small businesses will be the return of customers to their businesses, as job creation puts wages into the pockets of consumers, and consumers are once again able to afford to buy goods and services. We do not think there is a difference in the cost to the state between an executive order and it becoming codified as a law. It's an existing situation, so it's hard for us to understand this. I would ask for an aye vote. This is an important bill to the small business community, and I would also remind all of the members that don't forget to get your small business honoree in for California Small Business Day. Thank you.
Thank you, Betty Jo. Next, please.
Good morning, Madam Chair and members. My name is Mel Osagai on behalf of this Sacramento Black Chamber of Commerce, and also on behalf of the California State Chamber. Mr. Stone couldn't be here this morning. We are in support of this because we think it makes sense for California. It's smart to support a continuing program that puts small businesses in significant contracting situations with the state, creates jobs, and keeps businesses strong, and the biggest job producer in the state is small business. So we support this bill and hope that the committee will support it as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
Kevin Pedrotti, representing the National Federation of Independent Businesses. We're very much in support of this bill. We think that it would be beneficial to small businesses throughout the state. Thank you.
Madam Chair, Chris McKaylee on behalf of Natoma Technologies, a certified small business located here in Sacramento.
Welcome back. Yes, sir.
Good morning, Senators. Again, my name is Marvin Dean. I came up from Bakersfield, California. I don't live in the Senator District, but I felt so strong about this that this, to us in the Central Valley, is more of a jobs bill. It puts people to work. A lot of the small businesses hire a lot of the disadvantaged people in their neighborhood, typically people that are high unemployed, African-American, disadvantaged folks that are typically not gainful employed by a lot of the larger companies, and we don't believe, because I believe this is already in the executive order, the governor has a executive order of the 25% similar to this now, that by putting this in statute, it's not going to really have that much financial effect. So I would ask, again, we are very supportive, and the organization I'm here representing is too, the Kern County Minority Contractors Association and also the San Joaquin Valley Black Contractors Association, and I close on this. We believe this bill would benefit all California small business, irrespective to their ethnicity. So we ask for your support. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any other testimony in favor? And is there opposition testimony? And Finance, do you have a comment?
Pursuant to Governor's Executive Order S-0206, issued on March 29th, 2006, agencies were previously directed to achieve a 25% small business participation. However, agencies not achieving this goal and agencies outside the governor's authority, such as constitutional officers, could incur increased costs associated with the 5% small business bid preference. The extent of this fiscal impact is unknown because there's limited data available regarding the current usage of small business contracting for these entities. The consolidated annual report for the 2007-08 reflects the goal was achieved on a statewide basis. In 2006, with participation of 28.3%. However, the state fell short of the goal in 2008-09 at 23.8%, and the 2009-10 report has yet to be submitted to the Department of Finance.
Thank you. Senator Price, you know, I support this bill. We worked with you on when it was on suspense last year, but I do think that we want to go over these numbers again with you while it's on suspense and see what can be done to lower the costs and still keep the program in a robust form.
Yeah, I look forward to doing that. Again, we just disagree with the analysis. We don't think it is going to create that kind of expense, but I'll be happy to work with you to try to work that figure down.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And are you waiving presentation on 141?
That's correct.
All right, then we'll take that up when we get to the waive presentations. I saw Senator Simidian. Senator Simidian, you have a number of items. SB 27, want to start with that?
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. This, I know, is a candidate for suspense. One-sentence description of the bill is this is a CalPERS, CalSTRS pension spiking bill. Came out of committee, it was a semicolon there, came out of committee on a 5-0 bipartisan vote. Also involves the issue of revolving door, double dipping, and similar to the legislation that passed last year, Madam Chair, but was linked to another bill last year the governor had problems with. So we're back again. I respectfully ask for an aye vote if and when the measure comes off suspense.
All righty. Testimony in favor of SB 27. In favor? In favor? All righty. Seeing none. Is there... Beg your pardon? Yes. Opposition? Is there opposition? Come on up, please. All righty. Go right ahead. State your name.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Paul Smith with the Regional Council of Rural Counties. We are opposed unless amended on this bill. Our opposition stems from the provision in Mr. Simidian's bill dealing with 180-day prohibition on the use of retired annuitants. We feel in local government that that is a very, very unwise thing to do, particularly for fiscal reasons. Counties and other local agencies do bring back retired annuitants as a cost saving. We would expect that cost saving to be applied when the state uses that practice. Again, we would ask that that provision be removed from the bill.
Next, please.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Senators Julie Broyles here on behalf of the California Association of Joint Powers Authority, as well as the County Supervisors Association of California, also on the same points of opposition that Mr. Smith mentioned. We do want to point out that the risk management JPAs that we work with are very specialized skill set to be a manager, and even with a year's notice of retirement, we are frequently unable to find a new manager. We do also ask for that amendment that the 180 days be struck from the bill.
Thank you. Next, please.
Curtis Hill on behalf of the State Sheriff's Association, also opposed for the same reasons.
The 180-day?
Yes, ma'am.
All righty. Other testimony in opposition, seeing none. Finance, do you have a comment?
That although the cost to administer this bill would be minor and absorbable, the bill includes the provision that would prevent the retired annuitants. We do have a little bit within 180 days from the date of retirement. And we just wanted to note that the governor does have a broader proposal to deal with both the final compensation as well as the retired annuitants. And the administration is looking forward to working with the senator on these issues.
Thank you. Then this item goes to suspense, and we'll move on to SB 28. This is electronic wireless vehicles in your car. And you've taken amendments on this, Senator Simidian?
I have.
All right, then we will... probably be able to pass it, but let's hear your statement.
Members, there is one. This is a an increase to the existing $20 base fine for a violation of California's hands-free or texting laws. The $20 base fine, as many of you know, is a fraction of the sort of standard or default fine of $100 that's the typical base fine for driving in the carpool lane, littering while you're driving, riding in the trunk of the car while it's moving. We had hoped that that modest base fine would be sufficient to change behaviors. Good news, bad news is in the immediate aftermath of the bill being passed, we saw a 20% reduction in fatalities on the highway. That is 700 fewer fatalities a year. We saw a 20% reduction in collisions. That is 75,000 to 100,000 fewer collisions per year than we had seen in the previous 3 to 5 year averages. That being said, information from AAA, as well as our own Office of Traffic Safety, OTS, suggests that compliance is probably only at about 60 or 70%. That confirms, I think, what many of you have seen anecdotally, that there are still folks out there who are on that handheld, still folks out there texting. I wanted to increase the penalty to $50, to the base fine to be $50, try and provide a somewhat more significant deterrent. It is still only half the standard fine that is the default in most cases for a vehicle code violation. The one change from the bill last year, which came out of this committee, Madam Chair, is there was some controversy. In fact, we had opposition last year from the California Conference Board of the Amalgamated Transit Union, from the Teamsters, and from the California Conference of Machinists, because there was a point on your driver's license for a first offense. The compromise we've reached is that that point now would only be for a second or subsequent offense, only on a second or subsequent offense. With that amendment, the three groups that I've mentioned have all removed their opposition and are no longer opposed to the bill. I think we can take a good law and make it even better, and I would respectfully ask for an aye vote.
Thank you. Testimony in favor? Testimony in favor. Is there opposition? Please have a seat, ma'am.
Thank you. My name is Eileen Okerblom.
And a little bit louder, please. Okay.
My name is Eileen Okerblom. I live in Santa Maria. I'm here today to be a voice for my 19-year-old son who was hit and killed by a texting driver. Eric had just finished his first year at Berkeley. He was home for the summer. He was training to join the Berkeley cycling team. He was riding his bicycle on a straight road in broad daylight with no visual obstructions. A driver hit him going 60 miles per hour, didn't brake, didn't swerve. His helmet was knocked off. He was thrown 140 feet to a violent death. Mm-hmm. The driver denied any distractions. Later, court ordered phone records show that texting had occurred, both incoming and outgoing, at the time that Eric was struck. Senate Bill 28 is about saving lives, and not just a few, but thousands every year. You as legislators have the power and the choice to save lives with so very little effort. I am a grieving mother. I will always be a grieving mother, but what I have to say today is beyond grief. I hope you will truly hear what I have to say. Texting while driving is deadlier than drunk driving. It increases the risk of a crash by 23 times. This is 6 times more than driving drunk. It is the deadliest distraction behind the wheel. Teenagers send an average of 85 texts a day. 90% of teenagers admit to texting behind the wheel. Driver handheld cell usage increases the collision probability by 400% and is equal to that of a legally intoxicated driver. 63% of the nation's licensed drivers say that they routinely use a cell phone while driving. When California criminalized driver handheld cell use in 2008, the rates were cut in half. In 2011, driver cell use is twice the pre-ban level. I think everyone has caught on that it's unlikely they'll get caught, and if you do take that risk, the ticket is very minimal. The current trivial base fine of $20, with the total cost of the ticket being $159 to $166 without a point, is the lowest penalty in the entire vehicle code schedule for two of the deadliest behaviors behind the wheel. Look around when you are driving. People on cell phones and texting while driving are everywhere. Mothers and fathers picking up and dropping off children at school. Coaches driving vans transporting large numbers of students. The driver of the super shuttle that I took from the airport last night was on a cell phone for the entire ride from the airport to the hotel. I frequently go to schools to bring awareness to the dangers of distracted driving. I have never had one student in one class ever say they have not seen their parents, their friends, or siblings not use a cell phone or text while they drive. The current penalty is clearly not working as a deterrent. While you are driving and you see all of those drivers on their cell phones and texting, they are no different than drunk drivers and more dangerous. You are at a much higher risk of being injured or killed by these behaviors behind the wheel than by a drunk driver. Almost everyone has a cell phone, and people think that they can use it behind the wheel, and they cannot. It is an epidemic, killing more people each year than the combined number of deaths in the Iraq and Afghan wars. They are preventable deaths, and you as legislators hold the power of prevention. You have the power, and I believe, shared responsibility to help prevent these needless deaths. I think Senator Simidian is a hero. He fought for years to get these behaviors banned. He tried to save my child. If there had been a severe penalty, a penalty of $1,000 for texting behind the wheel, I am sure that the driver who killed Eric would not have risked having to sell her truck to pay for that ticket. The base fine for parking illegally in a handicapped space in California is $250, with the additional fees that will cost $1,080.50. That is an effective deterrent. Don't park there unless you're handicapped. In Louisiana, littering first offense is $3,000 plus community service. That is a deterrent. Using electronic devices while driving is the new drunk driving. It took decades to initiate the laws and severe penalties for drunk driving. It looks like we're repeating the same pattern. We have over 50 scientific research studies and at least 6,000 dead bodies each year and 500,000 serious injuries as evidence of the danger. The National Safety Council estimates that the numbers are underreported by 50%. That means 12,000 dead bodies and 1 million people each year as evidence of the epidemic. California needs a penalty commensurate to driving while intoxicated. A substantial fine will increase driver compliance, prioritize law enforcement, and increase revenue. The collisions that occur because of this willful impairment are 100% preventable, extraordinarily expensive, costing California lost wages, legal fees, higher insurance and disability rates, and medical expenses. Many of these costs are paid for by the state of California, particularly for the uninsured and the indigent. The current minimal fee does not generate enough revenue, probably, to offset the costs. Do what it takes to stop the carnage on the road. If the penalties are high enough, they will work as a deterrent and generate revenue. A severe fine will quickly bring awareness and education to the people of California. Increasing the fine for the cell drunk makes good financial and legal sense, but it is also the right and responsible thing to do. Senator Smedian understands this and continues to fight endlessly for protection of innocent lives. I could not save my own child. All I can do now is stand up and have a voice for my dead child. I can stand up and put a face and a story to the true meaning of this legislation. I can stand up and try to save other sons and daughters. You hold the power of prevention. Behind the wheel, we hold life in our hands. And you hold life in your hands with your legislative decisions. And if anyone wants to be well informed on this, go to the U.S. Department of Transportation website. You'll also find Eric's story there if you go to distraction.gov. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. And I think I speak for every member of the committee in offering our condolences to you and acknowledging that your son's death is a terrible tragedy. I heard you testify in the Transportation Committee as well. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Senator Ahlquist.
This is a very important bill, and I'm very sorry for the mother's loss as a mother and a grandmother, and I'd love to be at it as a co-author while it's on suspense. And I hope to see it come off.
You've taken amendments on this, Senator Simonini, correct?
I have agreed to take amendments for the staff recommendation, and if we could add Senator Ahlquist as a co-author at this time, I'd be happy to do so.
Right, and Senator Ahlquist, then the motion would be do pass as amended.
I make the motion do pass as amended.
All righty, any other comments, members? Any other testimony, pro or con? Finance, you have your comments?
The Department of Motor Vehicles would not have any anticipated additional costs as a result of this measure.
All righty, then we'll call the roll.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters? Ahlquist?
Aye.
Ahlquist, aye. Emerson? Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye. Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner? Steinberg?
All righty, that is 4-0. You need one more, Senator Simidian. We'll keep the roll open for the absent members. And then we'll go to SB 36, and this is a candidate for suspense.
Thank you. That being the case, Madam Chair, I will just indicate this is a measure which has no cost to the state, provides authorization to counties to provide health care coverage if they wish, thereby reducing cost pressure on the state. Essentially, it is a way for California counties to access federal funds which have been made available by federal action, but which are currently unavailable to California counties as a result of limits in state law. We remove those limits, and that allows counties, if they wish, to access those funds. I think it makes sense on a financial basis, well, a healthcare basis. Respectfully, request an aye vote when the measure comes off suspense, I hope.
Thank you. We'll go to your witnesses.
Good afternoon. Devin Anderson on behalf of San Mateo County. We're the sponsors of this measure. The bill would essentially allow the county to cover 350 children and attract approximately $200,000 in federal funds annually. We appreciate your consideration moving forward.
Thank you.
Nicole Worleman on behalf of the Alameda County Board of Supervisors, as well as the City and County of San Francisco in support.
Thank you.
Jillian DeVores with the Urban Counties Caucus in strong support of the bill. Thank you.
All righty. Other testimony in favor? Is there any opposition?
Thank you all.
Finance, do you have a comment?
The bill would not impact the general fund. The annual costs of approximately $270,000 to $360,000 per participating county would be split equally between the federal and local funds. The fiscal impact of this bill are unknown beyond January 1, 2014, when the federal health insurance exchange component of the federal health reform becomes effective.
Thank you. Members, this is a candidate for suspense. So seeing no comments, it will go there.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just a brief clarification. I think finance will bring it up. I saw some raised eyebrows on the cost. I just want to point out that's an optional cost if counties choose to provide this health care. So there is no cost burden imposed on anyone who doesn't want it. That's just what the dollar amounts are if a county chooses to provide the health care.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
And we'll go on to SB 164, personal tax contributions.
Thank you. And I believe that this is also a suspense candidate,
it is
Madam
indeed.
Chair. This is simply an extension, members, of a tax checkoff for the Child Abuse Trust Fund and the Endangered Species. I would only mention, Madam Chair, these are two of the most popular checkoffs on the state income tax form at the present time. So they've been quite popular, generating roughly $500,000 a year from voluntary contributions from members of the public who choose to check them off. Not only is there no direct cost to the state, but in fact, this is money that comes to the state because both of these checkoffs are sending money to California state government. Would hope that would be a basis for the measure to come off the suspense calendar and ask for an aye vote at that time.
Thank you. Testimony, please.
Madam Chair and members, I'm Sharon Scott Dow with the Advancement Project, and we're in strong support.
All righty. Next.
Madam Chair and members of the committee, Christopher Trunell here on behalf of Audubon, California. We were sponsors of the original legislation back in 83, been supportive all five times. The legislature has re-upped the program, and I just want to reiterate, it's a great deal for the state and strongly support. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other testimony in favor? Is there any opposition? Finance, do you have a comment?
The Franchise Tax Board has estimated that the personal income tax revenue could be reduced by about $40,000 annually beginning in 14-15 as a result of this bill, but subsequent conversations with FTB has they've informed us that that is like the average cost for all of these checkoffs, and given that these are two of the more popular ones, it could be upwards of $60,000.
Thank you. Any other comments, members? This goes to suspense then, and Senator, you're taking up your final item. SB 178, this is a due pass with amendments, members.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And as you mentioned, there are amendments here to address any potential cost concerns that might be there. Members will recall that a couple of years ago, Assemblymember Fuhrer and I authored a pair of bills to help implement the Schwarzenegger administration's green chemistry initiative. And during the subsequent period, we found that having a science panel that can really make sure that these are fact-based decisions and science-based decisions has been immensely popular, important rather. What we have also discovered, however, is that given the range of talents and expertise, it often makes sense just to have subgroups working together on these issues rather than the full Green Ribbon Science Panel. This measure simply authorizes those subgroups to do work as a subset of the larger panel and to focus their expertise where appropriate on individual, more narrowly focused topics. We have agreed to take amendments, and I would ask for an aye vote.
We have one. All right. Testimony in favor? Any testimony in favor? Any opposition testimony? Senator Semiti, in the analysis points out a $3,000 conference call. Are we going to look into that?
Yes, we are. That, for the record, that's not a call that was originated in my office, Madam
Chair.
Very
good. Thank you for clarifying that.
But I just want to say that raised some eyebrows, as you can imagine, not only in our office but elsewhere. The goal was to pull together expertise in a smaller group. It seems to me that can be done in a more affordable way. So we're going to be focusing on that. But that's the reason for the limitation on the number of these calls, just to make sure that, you know, if there is an improvement, my expectation is that there should be, that there is some limit on cost,
if
that's the rate. Thank you.
Finance, do you have a comment?
The panel has already formed subgroups consistent with the bill's provisions and will begin subgroup meetings in April of 2011, so this month, and therefore we believe that the measure would not have any additional costs.
All righty. Thank you. This is a do pass?
I move do pass as amended.
Thank you, Senator Ahlquist. Any other comments, members? Then we'll call the roll.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters? Ahlquist?
Aye.
Ahlquist, aye. Emerson? Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye. Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner?
No.
Runner, no. Steinberg?
Thank you, Senator Semidian.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, members.
And that is 4-1. You need one more vote. We'll hold the roll open for the absent members. Yes. We're going to take up some of the items that are the members have waived presentation. So we'll start with two items by Senator Pavley. This is for the audience members. I'll take opposition and support testimony on all the items. The members will not be speaking. SB 61 by Senator Pavley has to do with authorizing wiretaps. Is there testimony in favor? Is there opposition testimony? Seeing none, Finance, do you have a comment?
The judicial branch indicates that this measure has the potential to add to the court's caseload, which increases backlogs and could create pressure to the general fund to create new courts to handle the increased caseload.
All righty, that item moves to suspense. Next, we have SB 179, also by Senator Pavley, having to do with parole for sex offenders. Is there testimony in favor? Anyone in the audience want to testify in favor? Or anyone opposed? Is there opposition? Finance, do you have a comment?
Both CDCR and the Department of Mental Health indicated to Finance that this bill would result in minor and absorbable costs.
All righty. Then Senator Price has SB 141 having to do with the payment for elections. SB 141, is there testimony in favor? Oh, good. Come on up.
Madam Chair and members, Ed Behrens on behalf of the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors, sponsors of the bill. The bill is a straightforward one. It would just restore an authorization for reimbursement of special elections called for the filling of state assembly, and congressional and Senate seats. Over the past decade, the county has had 13 of the 20 special elections called. And out of those 13 elections, six of those resulted in runoffs that required the conducting of six additional elections. In this year alone, the county has conducted two special elections and has more special elections on the books. And these costs do represent a considerable unreimbursed cost to the county. We do request that you vote aye on this bill or that you pass the bill out of committee.
Thank you. And you're in favor?
Yes, we're the sponsor of the bill.
Next, please.
Jelena Vorce with the Urban Counties Caucus, also in support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jean Hurst on behalf of the California State Association of Counties, also in support.
Thank you. Any other testimony in favor? Is there opposition testimony to Senator Price's SB 141? Opposition? Seeing none, Finance, do you have a comment?
The average cost per election in recent years is approximately $1 million. Based on the historical number of these elections, this bill could likely cost millions of dollars annually to the general fund.
Thank you. That item moves to suspense. Our next one on waiving presentation is Senator Hernandez. Two items, SB 270, state employee compensation. Is there testimony in favor of SB 270 by Senator Hernandez? Any opposition testimony to SB 270 by Senator Hernandez? Are you coming up for this one? Already? That's all right. Take your time. This is support testimony?
Yeah.
All righty. Take it.
For 270. SCAU Local 1000 in support.
Thank you.
Dina Marie McGowan with the California State Employees Association, also in strong support.
For 270. Any opposition testimony to 270? Finance, do you have a comment?
Well, this bill would not generate additional costs for the state. It would reduce the administration's flexibility in managing limited cash reserves in the absence of an approved state budget, and the Department of Finance is opposed to this measure.
Opposed. All righty. That item goes to suspense, and we'll move on to SB 635, training, health care training. Any testimony in favor? In favor. Seeing none, is there opposition testimony to SB 635? Seeing none, Finance, do you have a comment on this one?
I do, Madam Chair. Current law requires that fines and penalties that accumulate beyond $1 million in the Managed Care Administrative Fines and Penalties Fund annually be transferred to the Major Risk Medical Insurance Fund. This amount varies, but is approximately $2 million annually. Concerns are three-based. First, that the state's current fiscal challenge, it's difficult to forecast the financial circumstances of 2014, and thus it would be premature to prioritize the use of excess funds to expand any program. Secondly, there is no statutory mandate that requires Mr. MIB enrollees to abandon their coverage in the future, even with the advent of federal health care reform. And finally, if all Mr. MIB employees found other coverage as of January 1, 2014, Mr. MIB still would have fiscal responsibilities beyond 2013.
Thank you. Any other comments, members? This item goes to suspense. That's SB 635. Next is Senator Negrete McLeod's SB 350 on death benefits for PERS. Any pro testimony? In favor testimony? Opposition testimony? Finance, do you have a comment?
The administrative costs for CalPERS would go down as a result of having one pool to administer rather than three. According to CalPERS, the level one benefit is overfunded by 1,053% with a balance of $26.7 million as of June 30th. There are 83 participants receiving benefits. The level two benefit is overfunded by 342% with a balance of $6.9 million. And there are 62 participants receiving benefits. The level one and two benefit pools are both closed. The level three benefit is overfunded by 271%.
Very good, thank you. That item goes to suspense. And we'll finish up the last wave presentation. Oh, no, we have two to go, I'm sorry. Senator Wright has SB 296 on criminal street gangs. SB 296, is there testimony in favor? Is there opposition testimony? Seeing none, Finance, do you have a comment?
The judicial branch indicates that it could create pressures on the general fund to handle the increased caseload.
All righty, that item goes to suspense. That's SB 296 by Senator Wright, and the last item for which presentation has been waived is Senator Dutton's SB 395, and that is on sales and use taxes, exemptions thereof. Is there testimony in favor? Mr. McKaylee? Don't rush. We're here. This is in favor of SB 395.
It is, Madam Chair. California Grocers Association in support, California Aerospace Technology Association, and my colleagues at the California Manufacturers and Technology as well. Thank you.
Any other testimony in favor? Is there opposition?
Lenny Goldberg, California Tax Reform Association, multi-billion dollar cost, very clear, unclear identification of benefit. Thank you.
That item goes, any further testimony? Seeing none, then Finance, do you have a comment?
The Board of Equalization estimates that the general fund revenue loss from the sales and use tax exemption provided for in this bill is as follows. In 2011-12, it would be $0.6 billion. In 2012-13, it would be $1.36 billion. In 2013-14, it would be $1.45 billion. And because the new partial exemption, the BOE states that they would have incurred costs for administrative costs attributable to the programming, return revisions, and the return processing.
Thank you. And that item goes to suspense. That is SB 395 by Senator Dutton. Members and the public, Senator Liu's item, SB 336, is put over. He's ill today. Senator Hancock, I see you there. You have two items. Can we start with SB 259? It's a candidate for suspense.
Yes, thank you very, very much, Madam Chair. SB 259 was introduced to include the ability to choose collective bargaining to graduate student research assistants at the University of California who are not currently covered under the Higher Education Employer-Employee Relations Act, called HERA. A majority of the student employees at the University of California and at CSU, including teaching assistants, readers, and tutors, have the opportunity to choose collective bargaining under HERA. However, the Public Employee Employment Relations Board determined that under the current language and statute, teaching assistants, readers, and tutors are covered, but research assistants are not. Graduate students frequently work as both TAs and RAs. During their time at UC, they can be teaching assistants one semester, research assistants the next. It is confusing, and they do actually lose benefits such as family leave, grievance and arbitration procedures, child care subsidies when they change category. About 85% of the research assistants are funded by non-state sources. There will be little increased costs to the state, and we believe that the administrative costs that UC is estimated for collective bargaining are extremely high, and look forward to working with committee staff and UC while the bill is on suspense. With me today to make a brief statement is Marianne Massenburg from UAW, the sponsor.
Thank you.
Of the
bill. We'll go to your witnesses. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Senators, Marianne Massenburg, UAW Local 2865. We represent the 12,000 teaching assistants already at the University of California, and we're seeking to represent the research assistants as well. The bill simply extends the basic right to choose collective bargaining to the research assistants. There's no inherent cost to that right. We want to say, too, that the administrative costs estimated by the university to engage in collective bargaining, to staff collective bargaining for UC, we anticipate that PERB, the Public Employment Relations Board, will combine the graduate student researchers with the teaching assistants in one bargaining unit. Therefore, there would just be one round of bargaining that already is happening, and not a second round of bargaining incurring additional costs. Also, in terms of UC's projected costs of any increased compensation, that would obviously only come as a matter of negotiation. The university is capable in bargaining of saying no, so any projected increases would be within the university's control. Thank you very much. We also look forward to working with Appropriations and UC.
Thank you. Additional testimony, please.
Yes, I'm Matt Haney. I'm here from the UC Student Association. I'm the executive director. We represent the over 250,000 UC students, and we very strongly support this bill.
Thank you. Next, please.
Madam Chair, members, Deanna Furman from the California Nurses Association. We represent the registered nurses at the UC Medical Centers and are part of the UC Coalition. We also strongly support this bill.
Thank you. Any other testimony in favor? And we need those chairs, please. Testimony in favor? Thank you. Welcome.
Good afternoon. Dina Marie McGowan with the CSU EU Local 2579, also in support.
All righty. This is SB 259. Any other testimony in favor? Is there opposition? Opposition? Welcome.
Madam Chair and members, Karen French on behalf of the University of California.
Welcome back.
Thank you. We're in opposition to SB 259. Current law has an express exemption for graduate student researchers whose work is integral to their educational objectives. We believe that the bill would change the fundamental relationship between faculty and student and turn it into management and employee relationship. It also could increase time to degree, and we provide the committee with our estimated costs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other testimony opposed to the bill? Opposed. Seeing none, Finance, do you have a comment?
The University of California indicated that it could incur costs between $10 million and $18.1 million in 2011-12 if all of the student employees who were able to unionize and have collective bargaining rights, as this bill would authorize, did so. Hastings also has stated potential costs, although unspecified, as a result of collective bargaining negotiations with its student employees. The CSU has indicated that the bill would not pertain to their student employees who already have the ability to organize and thus are covered by collective bargaining processes.
Thank you. And this item goes to suspense, so we will go now to SB 234 by Senator Hancock. Please begin whenever you're ready.
Thank you very, very much, Madam Chair. SB 234 is a bill that will promote uniformity and fair competition between internet, mail order retailers, and our local brick and mortar California businesses. It is essential to reforming state tax collection to keep up with changes in technology. The analysis indicates some minor upfront costs to the BOE, but these will be far outweighed by the revenue gains from this measure. California, like many or most other states in the union, levies use taxes on goods consumed in California produced outside of California. There is not now, nor has there ever been, a tax exemption for internet sales. However, many Californians are unaware that when they purchase products from an internet vendor, these product purchases are subject to the state's use tax. Such non-compliance takes needed revenue from our schools, our public safety, and environmental protections. The BOE estimated last year about, something over $1 billion was simply unpaid. Improvement in tax compliance would increase state revenues by millions of dollars. Current California law relies on consumers to collect and remit the use tax themselves. SB 234 would give the BOE more tools to require that out-of-state vendors collect and remit the use taxes, as all in-state and many out-of-state businesses do right now. This important change will simplify tax law and support our businesses that fairly comply with sales and use tax. We have a wide coalition of support.
Thank you, Senator Hancock. We'll go to your witnesses.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Alan LaFaso on behalf of Board of Equalization member Betty Yee, who's the sponsor of the bill. I'll be brief. As Senator Hancock said, we have a $1.2 billion tax gap of uncollected use taxes. And at a time of fiscal crisis, what this bill fundamentally is about is giving the state tools to collect those taxes and address the fiscal problems associated with that tax gap. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
Eleni Goldberg, representing independent booksellers in California, as well as the California Tax Reform Association. We actually have long thought that and disagreed with the Board of Equalization with regard to whether they already have long arm capability, as this bill clarifies. We see this as a necessary clarification of current law, because the BOE really needs to have the clarity that we would argue that they already have, but they don't see it that way. So important bill, to clarify the law.
Thank you. Next, please.
Nicole Wortelman on behalf of the City of Berkeley and AC Transit. This measure will help restore parity for in-state businesses with their out-of-state counterparts.
Next, please. Yeah.
Steve Cruz on behalf of Target Corporation and the Home Depot. We support the legislation. We collect the sales tax on both sales that occur at our retail locations and online. We think this is important to ensure that all retailers collect the tax and level the playing field. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
Madam Chair and members, Dominic DeMari here on behalf of Best Buy, a bricks and mortar seller of retail electronics here in California, also in support of this bill, for the reasons previously stated relative to evening the playing field for retail sellers. Thank you.
Thank you. Next,
Madam
please.
Madam Chair, members, Jean Hurst on behalf of the California State Association of Counties, also in support.
All righty. Any other testimony in favor? In favor. Then the opposition can come up also. Opposition to SB 234. Come on up and state your name, please.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members. Jeffrey Leacox of Greenberg Traurig on behalf of the Internet Alliance, an association of 20 online internet retailers. We'll focus our comments, although there are many reasons we oppose the bill, we'll focus on the fiscal implications. SB 234 should be a candidate for suspense, first because there's no money here. If this bill is enacted, anyone that the Board of Equalization tries to impose a use tax collection obligation on simply will change their business model. In fact, two large internet retailers have already indicated that they would terminate California affiliates. It will cost, as the analysis points out, money to implement this measure by regulation. At the same time, it will cost the state lost personal income tax revenue when those affiliates I mentioned are terminated. We estimate that they paid up to $124 million of income tax in 2009 based on the income they received from sales referrals. Finally, we'd point out that this bill contradicts measures that the legislature has recently enacted that focus on collecting the tax from the person who owes it, which is the user of the property here in California. California has now a line item on the personal income tax return. We've just enacted through SB 86 in the budget this year a use tax lookup table, and 2 years ago through the Calderon measure that started out life as AB 711 and ended up being enacted in special session, we created a B2B approach that has generated up to $50 million so far, and BOE estimates over $600 million in the coming years. Our point is that this bill comes at use tax collection from the retailer side, while California is doing a good job of moving to more aggressively collect from the purchaser side. Thank you.
Next, please.
Madam Chair, members, Tim Coyle representing the Direct Marketing Association, and the only thing I would add to Mr. Leacock's testimony, we're opposed to the bill, is the profound uncertainty that it creates by failing to define in statute what constitutes nexus and what obviously, retailers would be affected by the new law. For those reasons, we're opposed.
And finally, Madam Chair, the lobbyist where Caltex asked me to indicate they're opposed as well, but couldn't remain for the hearing. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Members, this is a do pass. Other comments?
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion that we move this to suspense. We believe that Amazon.com and others will eliminate their affiliate programs, thus costing money to the general fund and to personal income taxes. So with that, I'd like to move this to suspense. Make a motion to move it to suspense.
Thank you, Senator Walters. So Senator Walters moves, makes a motion. Well, I need a timeout here 1 second. Since we don't usually make a motion to suspense, we'll figure it out.
Sorry.
Okay, so she can make a motion for suspense. All right, Senator Walters is properly made a motion for suspense. We're going to hear from Finance, and then I'll take other brief comments on the motion, and then we'll call the roll. Finance?
Madam Chair, members, according to the Board of Equalization, a revenue estimate for this bill would produce state and local revenues of as much as $209 million in 11-12, which is half-year effect, and $374 million in 12-13. And I would just like to note for the committee that that is based on a static assumption that everything that they could reach, they would collect. Of that amount, $152 million in 11-12 and $317 million in 12-13 is related to the law that establishes nexus with New York. So the Department of Finance, working with the Board of Equalization, has revisions on that first number. And the first is that adjusting for Amazon's expected response and assuming zero revenues for the highly uncertain eBay component, it would bring the revenue estimate to the piece related to that New York nexus down to $39 million in 11-12 and $84 million in 12-13. Should the New York nexus component be struck down entirely, the Board of Equalization estimate has provided us with an estimate of $11 million to $57 million in state and local revenue, which assumes 1 to 5% of the lost use tax revenue that would be able to be recouped. So the best case scenario from BOE is on a full year basis, $374 million. And in the worst case scenario, would be $11 million.
And just give us those last two numbers again, Ms. Anginito.
It would be between 11 and 57
million. A low of $11 million annually up to 57, and that's your most conservative estimate?
That is the most conservative estimate.
That's taken in the court cases and being able to reach the taxable.
Right.
Okay. Senator Walters.
It's a question of finance. Would the businesses have to pay the tax if they want to litigate under this bill?
That's a legal question that I'm not.
Until the court decision, do you mean?
Yeah. If they want to litigate, do they have to pay the tax first?
I don't have an answer to that question.
Is there anybody in the audience that does?
I think the Ledge Council is here.
Aaron Silva, Office of Legislative Council. I mean, that's a tough question to answer.
A little louder, please.
That's a tough question to answer off the cuff. I mean, I suppose they could, if they challenged it, they could move for some immediate injunctive relief to stay it, but we'd have to look at it more in depth to know how it would operate in the event of litigation.
Yeah, do you know the answers?
Yeah, very briefly.
Madam Chair, Eric Metke, Nielsen Merksmer, also representing the Internet Alliance. When legislation expanding Nexus was passed in the 80s, the direct market.
Do you have anything more recent? You know, can the. Will they pay?
Ninth Circuit case.
No, yeah, just one moment. He's got the floor.
The answer is the Ninth Circuit of the United States Court of Appeals ruled that the DMA had standing to bring challenges to the Nexus statute without paying the tax.
Until a decision is made.
Until a decision of.
Okay. Mr. Goldberg, very briefly.
Because this tax is due and payable from the consumer, those that do not collect, if they lose the case, would be liable. So in the very current case where Amazon says we're not required, they immediately started collecting because if they lose, they'll owe hundreds of millions of dollars out of pocket. So it would be, unless the judge were to say, put a stay, they would collect.
You know, we had a fairly thorough policy hearing on this. Clearly, it's a controversial bill with court cases pending and other states taking different actions. But I think it's clear that there is significant upside here, maybe from $11 million on the very low side to several hundred million dollars a year. So there is more revenue probably coming into the state from the passage of a bill like this than there is loss of revenue. And I think that is the basis upon which the analysis says this should be a pass to the floor rather than suspense. And I think we're clearly on the right ground there. But I'd be happy to give you a chance to respond.
Well, I would have to respectfully disagree. Oops, got my words wrong. And I think this further proves a reason that it really should go to suspense so that we can look at it further. I do believe it's going to have significant consequences when it comes to our revenues, and we are again trying to make it more difficult for businesses to operate in the state of California. So with that, I would like to, again, move this to suspense. Yeah.
Okay. The Senator Walters has the motion on the floor and is asking for an aye vote. Clearly, there is information before us that shows a no vote is in order. The chair asks for a no vote. Would the author like a brief comment, very brief, please?
Was simply going to comment that the loss of jobs to our own brick-and-mortar stores is quite substantial and something that we should be very mindful of, because the money that they collect goes right through our local economies and builds them. And I would, do you want me to
I would like to dispense with this motion first. So we have a motion before us. Senator Walters asking for an aye vote. Chair asking for a no vote. Call the roll, please.
Kehoe?
No.
Kehoe, no. Walters?
Aye.
Walters, aye. Alquist?
No.
Alquist, no. Emerson? Emerson, aye. Liu? Pavley? Price?
No.
Price, no. Runner?
Aye.
Runner, aye. Steinberg?
No.
Steinberg, no.
Ayes 3, noes 4. I'll close the roll now just so we can dispense with this so the motion fails. I heard your comments, Senator Emerson. Can't believe we lost. I need a do-pass motion from Senator Alquist. I would really like to be able to take up this motion, Senator Hancock, if you'll indulge me.
I will indulge you,
Madam
Chair. Thank
you. All righty. If there's any other comments, members, can we call the roll on the motion? Do pass.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters?
No.
Walters, no. Alquist?
Aye.
Alquist, aye. Emerson?
No.
Emerson, no. Liu? Pavley? Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner?
No.
Runner, no. Steinberg?
Aye.
Steinberg, aye.
It's 3 ayes and 4 noes. I'll hold the roll open. What are we doing here? 4 ayes and 3 noes. We'll hold the roll open for Senator Pavley, who just stepped out. I know for a minute there, sorry. All right.
Madam Chair, are there other calls that you need?
Yes, there are.
If you don't mind.
And then we'll go to Senator Corbett for a very brief presentation on a suspense item. We are at... you're going to have to tell me where we are here.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. We're good.
Where?
Don't worry.
I know. 16.
Oh.
Yeah.
Are we going to go down through the whole room? We've got the whole file. Can we just add you on?
Sure. If there's no call. There's no calls.
Do we have any that are pending because of on call?
Just any on call. I mean, in call, we need.
Where no,
is
no,
okay.
No, not for you.
See you.
What? He's going to have to go back. Senator Pavley.
I didn't know if it's appropriate to add on to the Hancock bill.
Yes, we're going to ask you to add on to the Hancock bill, SB 234, State Board of Equalization. The count on the votes now is?
4-3.
4-3. We'll call the absent members.
Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye.
And the final vote then is 5 ayes, 3 noes. That measure is out. It passes. Senator Corbett, you're taking up SB 405 on judgeships. This is a suspense candidate.
Yes. Thank you very much, Madam Chair. You may remember this bill from last year. It was on suspense last year and successfully came off suspense last year. What Senate Bill 405 does is it allows for the conversion of 10 subordinate judicial officer positions to judge positions in the 2011-2012 fiscal year. Judges converted from subordinate judicial officers will be tasked with family law or juvenile law assignments. These are the same assignments previously presided over by the same subordinate judicial officers. In this economy, we are finding that the number of cases in family law and sadly in domestic violence and these sorts of cases are increasing. So it is important that we have judicial officers to take care of these cases. While the cases coming before the judicial branch have increased as a result of population growth, trial court judgeships have not kept pace with the demand. Authorized trial judge positions have grown only 8.5%, while the population in California has grown by more than 33%. According to the Judicial Council's fiscal impact report, the costs associated with expediting conversions can be and have been absorbed within existing resources. As I mentioned, this bill is similar to AB 2763 that you saw last year, and Judicial Council and the Family Law Section of the State Bar are both in support of this bill, and there's no opposition. Donna Hershkowitz with the Judicial Council is here to testify.
Thank you. Very briefly, please.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair and members. Donna Hershkowitz on behalf of the Judicial Council, sponsors of the bill. I would only reiterate that this bill does not increase the number of conversions. The legislature authorized 162 conversions in 2006. This bill simply provides the opportunity to expedite the conversions from subordinate judicial officer positions to judgeships. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please. Okay. Then any further support testimony? Any opposition testimony? Finance, do you have a comment?
Madam Chair, I don't have a file on this measure.
All right. This goes to suspense. Thank you, Senator
Cornyn. Thank you very much.
And Senator Walters will preside just while I present these two very quickly. The SB 186 is a wave presentation if you just want to call for pro and con.
Okay. SB 186, do we have any witnesses in support?
You're here for state claims?
186.
Okay, go right up there.
Go ahead. She's going to waive presentation.
Sure. The bill would grant the controller certain narrow authorizations to investigate or audit financial irregularities in determining whether or not counties, cities, and other local governments are complying with state and or county ordinances or local charters.
Les Kleinberg and Walter Barnes of the controller's office were the sponsors of the bill.
Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Okay, and this is going to move to suspense. Thank you. Finance, sorry.
Madam Chair, members, the State Controller's Office has indicated that it would require 17.9 positions at a total cost of $2.3 million in 2011-12 and $2.2 million in 12-13, requiring 100% of those funds from the general fund.
Okay, thank you. Okay, and that'll go to suspense.
Madam Chair, then I'll take up the state claims bill. This is SB 206, and this is an urgency measure, members. It would appropriate $600,000 from the Board of Chiropractic Examiners Fund to the Board of Chiropractic Examiners to pay for a stipulated settlement, a court settlement. The board recently suffered an adverse verdict at a trial where the jury award exceeded $1 million. These two cases are similar and argue that that we approve payment from the board's funds to settle this dispute. Department of Finance will speak, but I understand they're in support. And the executive officer of the board, Robert Paleo, is here to answer any questions. I ask for your aye vote on this state claims bill.
Witnesses in support?
Robert Paleo on behalf of the Board of Chiropractic Examiners in support.
Witnesses in opposition? Finance?
The Department of Finance is the sponsor of this measure, and we are in support.
Okay. Any comments from committee? Okay. And it's a do pass. Call the roll, please.
Kehoe?
Aye.
Kehoe, aye. Walters?
Aye.
Walters, aye. Alquist?
Thank you, sir.
Emerson?
Aye.
Emerson, aye. Liu? Pavley?
Aye.
Pavley, aye. Price?
Aye.
Price, aye. Runner?
Aye.
Runner, aye. Steinberg?
Six to zero, it is passed.
Thank you very much.
Thank
We are at the end of the file. We need to, we have about five or six items that are open for Senator Steinberg, but everyone else has voted. Members, we're going to go in order for those. There are a few members that need to cast votes now, in addition to Senator Steinberg. So the first item is SB 16 by Senator Rubio. The chair is aye, and the vice chair is no. Do you want to call the absent members?
Emerson? Lou?
No.
Emerson, no. Lou? Pavley?
Pavley, aye.
Pavley, aye. Steinberg?
All righty. And we'll replace the call. Next is, and this is the order in which they were heard, so it's not the same as the on your page. But I don't see any absences here, except for Senator Steinberg. Okay. Let's see. Well, I'm looking for Emerson or anyone else, so that's all right. All right. Here's Senator Simidian, item 28. This is texting while driving. SB 28, the count is, or the chair is aye. The vice chair has not yet voted. Will you call the absent members?
Walters?
No.
Walters, no. Emerson? Lou? Runner? Steinberg.
Alrighty. 4-1, we'll replace the call. Another item by Senator Simidian, 178 on hazardous materials, the working groups.
Walters?
No.
Walters, no. Emerson?
No.
Emerson, no. Steinberg?
And I'll replace the call. We didn't have Senator Office to review the order. She better be able to. Yeah, okay. Then she'll get it out now. Well, what about Steinberg? Members, we're all set. We're just waiting for Senator Steinberg. And I'll adjourn as soon as we close the roll. There's SB 206 by Kehoe, the claims bill. The count is 6-0. That bill is out. So we'll close that. Okay.